Unit 1, Rise of Nationalism in India. With the return of Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi from South Africa in 1950, the British government pursued a policy of free trade or laissez faire. Raw materials like cotton, jute and silks from India were taken to Britain. India became a procurement area for the raw material, and the farmers were forced to produce industrial crops like indigo and other cash crops like cotton for use in British factories. The Indigo Revolt of 1859-60 was one of the responses from the Indian farmer to oppressive policy of the British. Peasants through the Indigo Revolt of 1859-60 were able to force the planters to withdraw from northern Bengal. But the British extended their policy of non-intervention, laissez-faire, even to famines. As a result, millions of people died of starvation during the Raj. It has been estimated that between 1770 and 1900, 25 million Indians died in famines. William Digby, the editor of Madras Times, pointed out that during 1793 to 1900, alone an estimated 5 million people had died in all the wars around the world, whereas in just 10 years, 1891 to 1900, 19 million has died in India in famines alone. Sadly, when people were dying of starvation, millions of tons of wheat was exported to Britain. During the 1866 Orissa famine, for instance, while 1.5 million people starved to death, the British exported 200 million pounds of rice to Britain. The Orissa famine prompted nationalist Dadabhai Nauroji to begin his lifelong investigations to Indian poverty. The failure of two successive monsoons caused a severe famine in the Madras Presidency during 1876-78. The Viceroy Lytton adopted a hands-off approach similar to that followed in Orissa. An estimated 3.5 million people died in the Madras Presidency. The introduction of plantation crops such as coffee, tea and sugar in empire colonies such as Ceylon, Sri Lanka, Mauritius, Fiji, Malaya and the Caribbean islands and South Africa required enormous labor. In 1815, the governor of Madras received a communication from the governor of Ceylon asking for coolies to work on the coffee plantations. The Madras governor forwarded this letter to the collector of Tanjore, who reported that the people were very much attached to the soil, and unless some incentive was provided, it was not easy to make them move out of their native soil. But the outbreak of two famines, 1833 and 1843, forced the people without any prompting from the government to leave for Ceylon to work as coolies in coffee and tea plantations under the indentured labor system. The abolition of slavery in British India in 1843 also facilitated the process of emigration to empire colonies. In 1837, the number of immigrant Tamil laborers employed in Ceylon coffee estate was estimated at 10,000. The industry developed rapidly and so did the demand for Tamil labor. In 1846, its presence was estimated at 80,000, and in 1855 at 1,28,000 persons. In 1877, the famine year, there were nearly 3,80,000 Tamil laborers in Ceylon. Besides Ceylon, many Indians opted to emigrate as indentured labor to other British colonies such as Mauritius, Straits Settlements, Caribbean Islands, Trinidad, Fiji and South Africa. In 1843, it was officially reported that 30,218 male and 4,307 females had entered Mauritius as indentured laborers. By the end of the century, some 5 lakh laborers had moved from India to Mauritius. Indentured labor. Under this penal contract system, indentured laborers were hired for a period of 5 years and they could return to their homeland with passage paid at the end. Many improvised peasants and weavers went hopping to earn some money. It turned out to be as worse than slave labor. The colonial state allowed agents, Ganganis, to trick or kidnap indigent landless laborers. The laborers suffered terribly on the long sea voyages and many died on the way. The percentage of deaths of indentured labor during 1856-57 in a ship bound off Trinidad from Kolkata is as follows: 12.3% of all males, 18.5% of the females, 28% of the boys, and 36% of the girls, and 55% of the infants perished. With this aim, the English Education Act was passed by the Council of India in 1835. T.B. Macaulay drafted the system of education introduced in India. Universities were established in Bombay, Madras, and Calcutta in 1857. T.B. Macaulay was India's first law member of the Governor General in Council from 1832 to 1838. Before Macaulay arrived in India, the General Committee of Public Instruction was formed in 1833 with the responsibility to guide the East India Company on the matter of education and the medium of instruction. The committee was split into two groups. The Orientalist group advocated education in vernacular languages. The Anglicists advocated Western education in English. Macaulay was on the side of Anglicists and wrote his famous minute on Indian education in 1835. In this minute, he argued for Western education in the English language. His intention behind supporting the Anglicists was that he wanted to create a class of persons from within India who would be Indian in blood and color, but English in taste, in opinion, in morals, and in intellect. The reform movements of 19th century are categorized as 1. Reformist movements such as the Brahmo Samaj founded by Rajaram Mohan Roy, the Ratana Samaj founded by Dr. Atmaram Pandurang, and the Aligarh movement represented by Syed Ahmad Khan. 2. Revivalist movements such as the Arya Samaj, the Ramakrishna Mission, and the Deoband movement. 3. There were social movements led by Jyotiba Phule in Pune, Narayana Guru and Ayyangali in Kerala, and Ramalinga Adigal, Vaikunda Swamigal, and later Eothi Thassar in Tamil Nadu. Indian national consciousness emerged as a result of the rethinking triggered by these reforms. The Brahmo Samaj was founded by Ram Mohan Roy in 1828. Other socio-cultural organizations like the Pratana Samaj 1867, the Arya Samaj 1875 were founded subsequently. Roy's initiative was followed up by reformers like Kesav Chandra Sen and Ishwar Chandra Vijayasagar. Indian national movement dates its birth from the 1857 uprising. The outrages committed by the British army after putting down the revolt remained unavenged. Even the court martial law and formalities were not observed. Officers who sat on the court martial swore that they would hang on their prisoners, guilty or innocent, and if any dared to raise his voice against such indiscriminate vengeance, he was silenced by his angry collegiates. Persons condemned to death after the mockery of a trial were often tortured by soldiers before their execution, while the officers looked on approvingly. It is worth recalling what Elphinstone, governor of Bombay Presidency, wrote to Sir John Lawrence, future Viceroy of India, 1864, about the British siege of Delhi during June to September 1857. A wholesale vengeance is being taken without distinction of friend or foe. As regards the looting, we have indeed surpassed Nadir Shah. Repressive regulations like Section 124A of the Indian Penal Code, 1870, punishing attempts to excite disaffection towards the government, and the Vernacular Press Act, 1878, censoring the press, evoked protest. Abolition of custom duty on cotton manufacturers imported from England and levy of excise duty on cotton fabrics manufactured in India created nationwide discontent. It addressed the people on several issues affecting the country. Raja Ram Mohan Roy's Sambat Kaumudi, 1821 in Bengali, and Mirat-ul-Akbar, 1822 in Persian, played a progressive role in educating the people on issues of public importance. Later on, a number of nationalists, among them Amrit Bazar Patrika, the Bombay Chronicle, the Tribune, the Indian Mirror, the Hindu, and Swadeshamitran, were prominent. The mission of nationalism, in our view, is to recover Indian thought, Indian character, Indian perceptions, Indian energy, Indian greatness, and to solve the problems that perplex the world in an Indian spirit and from the Indian standpoint. One of the first attempts to organize and bend the grievances against the British came through the formation of the Madras Native Association, MNA, on 26 February 1852, an association of landed and business classes of the Madras Presidency. They expressed their grievances against the company's administration in the revenue, education, and judicial spheres. Gajula Lakshmi Narasu, who inspired the foundation of MNA, was a prominent businessman in Madras City. The association presented its grievances before British Parliament when it was discussing the East India Company's rule in India before the passing of the Charter in 1853. In a petition submitted in December 1852, the MNA pointed out that the Ryotwari and Zamindari systems had thrown agricultural classes into deep distress. The MNA petition was discussed in the Parliament in March 1853. H.D. Seymour, chairman of the Indian Reform Society, came to Madras in October 1853. He visited places like Guntur, Kadalur, Tiruchirappalli, Salem, and Tirunelveli. However, as the Charter Act of 1853 allowed British East India Company to continue its rule in India, the MNA organized an agitation for the transfer of British territories in India to the direct control of the Crown. MNA sent its second petition to British Parliament, signed by 14,000 individuals, pleading the termination of company rule in India. The life of MNA was short. Lakshmi Narasu died in 1886, and by 1881, the association ceased to exist. After the Madras Native Association became defunct, there was no such public organization in the Madras Presidency. As many educated Indians viewed the situation with dismay, the necessity for a political organization was felt, and in May 1884, the Madras Mahajana Sabha was organized in the inaugural meeting held on 16 May 1884, the prominent participants were G. Subramaniam, Veera Raghavachari, Ananda Charlu, Rangaya, Balaji Rao and Salem Ramaswamy. With the launch of the Indian National Congress after the completion of the second provincial conference of Madras Mahajana Sabha, the leaders, after attending the first session of the Indian National Congress INC in Bombay, amalgamated the MMS with the INC. The idea of forming a political organization that would raise issues and grievances against the colonial rule did not emerge in a vacuum. Between 1875 and 1885, there were many agitations against British policies in India. The Indian textile industry was campaigning for imposition of cotton import duties in 1875. In 1877, demands for the Indianization of government services were made vociferously. There were protests against the Vernacular Press Act of 1878. In 1883, there was an agitation in favor of the Hilbert Bill. December 1884, Alan Octavian Hume, a retired English ICS officer, presided over a meeting of the Theosophical Society in Madras. The formation of a political organization that would work on all India basis was discussed, and the idea of forming the Indian National Congress emerged in this meeting. The Indian National Congress was formed on 28 December 1885 in Bombay. Apart from A.O. Hume, another important founding member was W.C. Bonerjee, who was elected the first president. They were developing the indigenous anti-colonial ideology and a strategy on their own, which helped future mass leaders like M.K. Gandhi. Differences within the INC leaders like Bipin Chandrapal, Bal Gangadhar Tilak and Lala Lajpat Rai were advocating radical approaches instead of merely writing petitions, prayers and memorandums. These advocates of radical methods came to be called the extremists, as against those who were identified as moderates. Their objective became clear in 1897 when Tilak raised the clarion call, "Swaraj is my birth, right, and I shall have it." Tilak and his militant followers were now requesting Swaraj instead of economic or administrative reforms that the moderates were requesting through their petitions and prayers. They tried to instill nationalist consciousness through various means, including the press. When the INC was founded in 1885, one third of the members were journalists. Most stalwarts of the early freedom movement were involved in journalism. Dadabhai Navroji founded and edited two journals called Voice of India and Rasht Gafdar. Surendranath Banerjee edited the newspaper called Bengali. Bal Gangadhar Tilak edited Kesari and Maharatta. This is the means that they used to educate the common people about the colonial oppression and spread nationalist ideas. British rule in India. On 27 July 1897, Tilak was arrested and charged under Section 124A of the Indian Penal Code. Civil liberty, particularly in the form of freedom of expression and press, became the significant part of Indian freedom struggle. Dadabhai Navroji, known as the Grand Old Man of Indian Nationalism, was a prominent early nationalist. The Bombay Municipal Corporation and Town Council during the 1870s, elected to British Parliament in 1892. He founded the India Society 1865 and the East India Association 1866 in London. He was elected thrice as the president of the INC. Navroji argued that India has exported an average of 13 million pounds worth of goods to Britain each year from 1835 to 1872 with no corresponding return. When did Gandhiji return to India from South Africa? Answer: 1915. In which year English education was introduced in India? Answer: 1835. Find the odd one. Answer: Aurobindo Ghosh. 4. Swaraj is my birth right and I shall have it was said by answer Bala Gangadhar Tilak. 5. Match and choose the correct answer from the code given below. Answer: 3142. 6. Which one of the following is correctly matched? Answer: Madras Native Association 1852. 7. Which is the correct chronological sequence of the following associations? Answer: 3412. 8. The Indian National Congress was founded by answer: A.O. Hume. 9. The first president of the Indian National Congress was answer: W.C. Banerjee. 10. Who was called the Grand Old Man of India? Answer: Dadabhai Navroji. 11. Who wrote the book Poverty and Un-British Rule in India? Answer: Dadabhai Navroji. 12. Answer: A is correct and R is incorrect. 13. Which of the following statements are correct? Are Orisha Tamil? Answer: All of the above. 14. Answer: Both A and R are true and R is the correct explanation of A.